That's cool. Hello, folks. We're talking about cold weather. Robert, the whiskey scout, was talking about 20-something degrees. I said, that's January weather for Louisiana, December and January weather. Last week, we were up to 87 in one day. All right. Anyway, welcome to Stout Sunday. John and Neil A. still got the cold situation, head cold, can't smell, taste stuff too well. So maybe later today, a mystery beer might help him out. But today, on Stout Sunday, which I'm temporarily hosting, Alex was talking about it, but I think he said he had to work. We are doing porters and stouts. And we have myself from Louisiana, normally Louisiana Beer Reviews. We got Michael Komaroff from Brooklyn, New York City, New York.
Good morning.
Good morning. And we have Robert the Whiskey Scout from Kansas.
Good morning.
South, the West, and the North, and three regions. And we may have some other people joining. I put the link. So feel free to join. All are welcome. We're very eclectic. Now, and this morning I have, I'll show you, we'll go around the bend. There's some glare on me, but that's all right. There's Baltica 6 Porter. That's written in Cyrillic, so you can't really read it. But there's a new label, kind of a new sharp, fancy label. Baltica number 6. It used to have a pull cap, but I had to pry it off today. There, I got it. And I poured some. It's Coca-Cola brown, thin head. Don't get much head on this beer. No real lacing. And I'll tell you something about this. This is not an ale. Oh, let me update my banner. Sorry, y'all. I'm showing the wrong thing. I'm new to banners, you know. Now we got it right. This is not an ale. It's a lager. It's a dark lager. And it's 7% alcohol. They don't list the IBUs. And I have the website, one of the two websites brought up. It says here. Now, see, this website's making a mistake, or it's confusing me. Right? It says Baltica number 6 Porter, beer type, stout. Listen to this, y'all. Stout. I'm going to show you. I'm going to show everybody. Watch. Can y'all see the screen share?
Yep.
Stout. Russia, 7%. Award-winning Baltica 6. Now, it was introduced in 94. Comes full of flavor as well as a high density and strength. You also find hints of wine in the aroma. You see, I was saying black cherries when I was drinking this off air. No, I was saying raisins. Well, grapes, what do we make wine out of? Grapes. So, I don't understand the part about stout. Anyway, that's what I have. Now, Michael is going to show us what he has.
Okay. This is from Longmont, Colorado. Left hand. It is a nitro milk stout at 6% ABV and 25 IBUs. And this is a 13.65-ounce can, which is a little bit of an unusual can designation. When I picked it up, I thought it was going to be a pint. And then I realized that the can is a little bit shorter than a standard pint can. But it should have, when I do pour it, the nitro effect. And I guess I can pour it now.
Yeah, go ahead. Why not?
We got a lot of nice sound when I hit it.
Sure did.
Do a center pour, trying to get the maximum nitro effect. I will lift this up so everybody can see it.
Yeah.
Probably can't get the whole thing into this glass, but I don't know if people can see it. The light isn't great. You're getting the nitro action. It had poured at the beginning a darker brown. You're getting kind of a mixed kind of thing where the lighter brown coming up and kind of a mocha type head. And
yes, I see that.
It's settling.
Cascade.
It's settling in a little. The carbonation, it looks like it's really coming together. And I'll be able to pour the rest in as I drink some of it. But I'll be back to give a description after Robert gives
the nitro thing. Yep. All righty then. What I got for you guys is, whoa, that's way close. By Martin City, it's not, come on now. Ah, well, maybe it'll be better. Anyways, from Martin City Brewery. Martin City is on the south side of Kansas City and just a little east of the line. It's in Missouri. They have a lot of beers. They sell around here, too. They're good. I enjoy Martin City's offerings. This is the Imperial Alchemy. They do have an Alchemy, and then they got an Imperial Alchemy. This is bourbon barrel aged stout brewed with coffee and vanilla beans, brewed in collaboration with Alchemy Coffee. The barrels, I need to go back to the website real quick because the barrels come from, I can't remember, that's Kansas City Distillery. Give me just a second here. And they aged it for 3 months in bourbon barrels from Union Horse Distillery. Now, I've had one Union Horse whiskey I reviewed some time ago, and I need to try some more of their stuff. I didn't care for it too much, but I just think it was still too hot, still too young. It just wasn't, for a bourbon, it wasn't ready. But as any struggling distillery does, they try to put it out early so you can get more stuff. But anyway, that's beside the point. They do supply the barrels for these guys. It's in Kansas City too. I don't remember if it's on the Kansas side. I don't know. It might be on the Missouri side. I can't remember where it's exactly located, but anyway, I know it's just west of where these guys are, but I'm not sure if it crosses the line into Kansas or not. Anyway, the pour's really nice. That's really nice. Two-finger chocolate. Chocolate caramel head on top of it, caramel-colored head. You can't see through it either. This ought to be good.
Looks good.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, you want me to start?
No, we'll go back to the presentations.
Yep. I thought so.
Okay. Well, I've never seen that in Louisiana, so.
That's something you see here. Midwest.
Okay. I will update comments, folks. Okay. Flacco, instead of watching, you should get a stout and join, doggone it.
Yep.
Demand that you join, unless you don't feel like it. Then you can just watch. All right.
Paul's in the chat.
That sounds good. Paul Middlefruit.
Mm-hmm.
Get Jeremy there.
Join.
Jeremy, bring us out.
What's up with you? Where's your stout? Join. I demand it. Unless you don't want to, then you can just watch. All right. All right. Let me get this. I guess I'll keep the banner on. All right. Now, so I poured it. It smells very rich. If you don't like rich, tangy, kind of intense beers, you don't want this, believe me, okay? Because I'm going to tell you right now, you ain't going to like it. It's too rich, and it has tastes of raisins, dark, almost like syrupy raisins. The body is light, however, so that might appeal to you. It's kind of a light, medium body. There's also dates, and it might even be prunes. I don't know how you feel about drinking prune juice tasting beer. Dark roasted malts, and the aroma's following the taste, and the taste is following the aroma, so they kind of run together. There's some char, not burnt, but you get the charred, dark roasted. they've been making this beer for 26 years, so I think they know what they're doing, and it seems like they've improved it a little bit. It's hard to get fresh. We have trouble getting fresh Baltica beers in Louisiana. We get a lot of them, but they're all out of date. I don't really want to drink expired beer. This one happily was in date. Crisp finish. Remember, it's a lager. Does it remind me of Michelob Classic Dark back from the 90s? Well, not really. It's dark like that beer, but darker, and it's got more alcohol. This is 7%. I'm going to pour a little more. It's a bit of an odd thing. I'm going to tell you, if you're used to drinking regular old English porters, American porters, and stouts, I don't know how you can feel about it. There's a little coffee note also. You might find it too unusual to enjoy or something like that. Listen to these comments. Yeah, I got banners going. Like Bruce Banner. All right. I like nitros, but a lot of people don't like that funny mouthfeel. I'm starting to clear up now. I took some more cold medicine this morning. I'd definitely be down to examine the spike mystery later, and if I can't taste it, I won't feel too bad about it. Yeah, now that's very ironic, John, because you want to taste a mystery beer, but yet not be able to taste it. So how are you going to determine what kind of mystery beer it is? By how looped up you get? I know I'm being aggressive, but I'm doing it in a very friendly way. In a jocular, in a sense of jocularity. Now, going to Michael, who's good. I'm recommending this beer, y'all. I'm recommending it. I'm just saying get ready because it's kind of rich and you might find that it's not going to suit you.
Okay. As you can see, and I did get the rest of the can into the glass, the head is staying very solid at the top, beige or kind of mocha kind of looking head, and good looking beer for sure, and very dark brown color. Let me get a nose on it. See, it's the person who asked the question about the milk stout thing. You don't get the same intensity on your roasted malts in these. So you can smell it a little bit in the background, but it's not a solid roasted malt smell.
Yeah.
Smell it a little bit. But you're getting more, it seems to me, lack of a nose. There really isn't that much going on in the nitro. Just kind of like a mild smell. And you can just tell by the look of it that it's going to have a creamy mouthfeel. I've had milk stouts before, and I've had nitros before, but I will give it a taste.
Cheers to your tasting.
Cheers, everybody. Okay. I happen to be somebody who likes nitro, but I think I like the nitro effect because it downs the intensity in a stout, and yet you do get a subdued malt kind of feel to it. So you're getting kind of a combination. But if you're somebody who wants stout intensity, milk stouts probably are not for you, and nitros probably are not for you either. Because it's very subdued. It goes down pretty easy. It has a really creamy mouthfeel and kind of like a light to medium body as well. I don't know. I'm somebody who likes all stouts. I like the intense ones. I like the less intense ones as well. So I guess I'm a fan of pretty much all stouts. But somebody who wants to start out drinking stouts for the first time, I think milk stouts would be a good stout to start out because since the roasted malts are not the primary either nose or taste, you might like it because you're just drinking a creamy, kind of like a milkshake kind of beer. And you don't have, like I say, have that intensity. So I'm going to keep sipping on it. And I'll have a number for you whenever we come back around.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh.
This is a winner, winner, chicken dinner. On the nose. First up front, as it starts, and this is as it's warmed a little bit more, I've got even more notes now than when I start. How come I'm getting a little feedback here?
Yeah, I hear that feedback.
Is it me?
No.
I'm going to turn my speakers down a little bit. See if it's bad now. It's not as bad now, is it?
No.
Okay, my speakers might have been a little too loud. All right. You get the coffee and the vanilla up front, just like a coffee drink, just like you're getting on a coffee drink. You get that malty sensation that comes right behind it with that roasted malts. That's right behind it. And they, it's even smells, it comes across, smells sweet to the nose. I mean, it is very, it's very, I want to use a crazy word, luscious in the nose. I mean, this stuff is, I'm not going to say decadent, it's not overly sweet. It's not like some super sweet thing you're drinking, but this is on the sweet side. It's balanced in that note. Those are the first three things that comes up now when I smell it, because maybe because I've even had a few sips of it now, I do get a hint of that bourbon barrel note coming through on it. Because when you take the drink of it now into the palate, again, rich coffee. That's like a vanilla coffee drink you would get from Starbucks. I mean, flavor-wise, it's hitting all those notes. But the nice feeling of that bourbon barrel comes right in behind it with some caramel. The vanilla stays there. It's balanced. It's not overtly sweet. I'm getting the bitterness on the tongue, which the sweetness is not overriding that. So the balance is very – I'm enjoying it. I really am. And it sticks around. It finishes very well. I mean, it just lingers. You're not getting an acrid coffee. You're getting a rich coffee note, but not acrid. Mouthfeel, it is a medium body to it. It's not a heavy body. I kind of expected a little heavier body to it than it has, but it does have body, but it's just not that thick like you would get with a CBS or KBS or something along those lines. But it's really enjoyable, and you can regenerate a head with it pretty quickly. Oh, I'm enjoying this, guys.
Are you picking up the alcohol, the 9.2%?
No, not really. Just there is a little bit of a – maybe it drinks like a 3.2% beer. You know, you're not getting hardly anything on the alcohol at all. No. This can be dangerous. You could drink two or three of these with a few donuts in the morning.
So you get more of the dessert flavors than the booze flavor.
Yes, yes, yes. The sweetness is, but there's enough bitterness that balances that sweetness. It's not a total sweet bomb. You know, you get some that are just so sweet that that's all you're getting from. This is more balanced. This is very balanced because it starts off sweet. You get your sweets on the front of your tongue, and then your bitterness is on your back of your tongue as it rolls through your palate and on the sides and back. It delivers in both areas like it should. Now, I don't know if that makes any sense to you guys, but that's, if you look at your tongue palate a lot of times, you'll see, you can find it on bourbon. There's a few bourbon websites you can go to that tells you how your tongue delivers different parts of taste to your mouth. We're getting the whole sensation. It's literally transitioning. And that's what I like. With whiskey, with beer, I want to transition. This transitions. It delivers as it goes across the tongue. And you're getting a full experience.
Yeah.
So, and I'm enjoying it. I'm not going to say there's a total bunch of wild flavors. I mean, we're still dealing with just maybe just coffee, vanilla. And once you get in the palate, you do get some caramel along with it. You still get the roasted malts. Now, you're not in the bourbon barrel. As it warms, becomes more prevalent. And, of course, oh, I like bourbon, so that's not going to. That's just a bonus in my book. So you're getting a nice barrel effect in this. So I'm enjoying it.
Troganator. Okay. Back to the group view. people are talking wild. I think people are still kind of exuberant from last night, if you catch my drift. Looks like the all-night party ain't stopped.
Jay, I was going to say, somebody asked if they took an ice house beer and poured black coffee in, if that would be creating a coffee stout. And of course, the problem that you have when you do a cuvee like that, a combo, is you're not going to get the same effect because the whatever the beer is, whether it's a lager or an ale, it's not going to accept the black coffee and make it a stout. It's not going to change.
Right. I think he was just kidding around, of course, you know.
Because people do, Jay, do these cuvées where they mix stuff and they're, right, they're hoping for an effect, which you get sometimes and sometimes you don't.
Yeah.
I tried doing that before and it was a fiasco, actually. Then David Garlapine wanted to spruce up some Canadian breakfast stout, and so we added Heaven Hill Kentucky blended whiskey, and that actually worked. He's laughing. Go ahead, laugh.
I think it's interesting. I'm not laughing because I'm laughing because that's interesting. I would have never thought to try that. Don't misunderstand that laugh.
I had a little bit left, and he was like, "Now this is what this beer was missing." And I said, "Okay, you just never know, I guess." And so that video is still posted, and all of that. So all right, that was an interesting cuvée. Now I tried another one with tomato juice and hot sauce and all, and it was a total train wreck. Now going back to this, I don't know if Michael's ever had Wake Up Dead Nitro. You ever had that one from Left Hand?
Yeah, I have. That's a good nitro too. That's also from Left Hand, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've had that too.
I even made up a little song when I did my video. I was like, "Wake up, dead, wake up."
I think that might have had more alcohol though than this does. This is 6.
Yeah, I think that was nine.
So that was like an imperial.
I think some of our viewers woke up dead in a figurative sense, at least. better dead than red. Oh, wait, I'm wearing red.
Isn't Robert Orange Jay's colors Nebraska Cornhusker colors? Isn't that their red?
I don't know. I don't like the corn shuckers.
That's right. Now the hate comes. Here we go with the hate. All because of a bunch of very bitter.
Like the University of Oklahoma.
And I mean very bitter defeats. Anyway.
They ran from us. They ran from the Big 12, so I got no respect for them no more.
That was dirty. All right. Anyway, I agree with you on that. All right. Anyway. Oh, I could say some stuff about Nebraska that would titillize some people and enrage others. So I won't even go into dragging girlfriends down the stairs by their hair and still getting to play football. I'm not going there. Anyway.
Yeah. Well, we had problems in Oklahoma too.
Yeah. Anyway. No, I respect Oklahoma because they had the best team money could buy. And all right, anyway.
That's Texas.
Anyway, this beer, I'm making enemies faster than I can drink. Anyway, this beer is, I think, I was kidding around in all seriousness, but this beer is a strange product. A lot of Russian beers are strange, really. And I don't know how people drinking it would appreciate it. They might hate it. You know, they might literally hate it. On the other hand, I think some people would like the unusual characteristics of it. You got to give Baltica one thing. It's unique. They're not just ordinary. Even if you hate them, you might admire their strangeness. Which sometimes I'm that way. I'll hate something, but I'll give it credit for its unusual quality. And I will say that it could be me. Like I'll say, it might just be me. Although you can usually tell when something's low quality. I'm going to score this. I'm going to go, and I'm going to update the comments, y'all. Have no fear. I'm going to give it a 93, maybe too high. I don't think anybody would say it's too low. All I'm going to say is just check it out on your own and try it. But beware of the date. Check your dates, because this stuff's coming all the way from Russia. And there's an old problem, at least in the New Orleans area, of these coming in or being on the shelf even a year and a half out of date. And I would be wary of that. But otherwise, it's an interesting company, and we don't get everything they make. We do get the wheat beer, we get the porter, we get the Euro lager, get their strong Euro lager, the 8%, which can really knock you for a loop when you drink the big bottles of it, the big bottles. But anyway, I feel comfortable with 93, and I'm gonna close out by saying tomorrow night is Malty Monday. Jesse is encouraging people to wear a costume, and if not, he told me if I didn't want to wear a costume, I could bring that scary puppet that I had, which kind of freaked people out Wednesday. And then Tuesday morning, I have a mismatch. You want to watch a wasteful video? You want to waste time? Here's a chance to do so. I have Ron Rico, celebrated nowhere, but available many places, Gold Label, versus the 8-year-age Reserva Ocho Bacardi. If there was ever a mismatch on the internet, this will be it. The last two taste challenges I did with Ron Rico, I guessed it right on aroma only. Aroma only, I had it nailed. So there you go on that. Wild Card Wednesday's coming up, meaning bring anything you want, beer, wine, or liquor. If you bring liquor, we might, you know, josh around, kid around, but we're not going to really actually tease you, ridicule you.
Don't believe him.
Degradate you or any such thing. So if you want to drink wine, feel free. But people typically drink beer. But anything, beer, wine, liquor, I don't care. I'm so open-minded. I'm so open-minded that I'm closed-minded. But anyway, but no, I encourage everybody to watch that and join. And join. Now, Michael is going to tell us his score for the left-hand nitro.
Okay, I'm going to give it a 94, which is a 94, a solid A. But I do give the proviso for stout drinkers that nitro effect is definitely different than your typical, you know, carbon dioxide type beer, because the effect is different, but it's a good effect. I like it. And as it does warm, you do get a little bit more of the roasted malts in the taste than you do when it's colder. So you do get a little bit more as time goes on. The key to this, though, is the smoothness and the creaminess in the beer. If you like both those characteristics, most nitros do that for you. Easy drinking. It's 6%, and it drinks, you know, it's like a session. It drinks like a session beer. You know, it's not tasty, heavy alcohol. It's light. But I guess I would say I'm a nitro fan. But if you said to me, if I had to choose between nitro or regular stouts, I'm probably on the side of regular stouts.
Okay, fair enough. Fair enough.
But I will drink other nitros, though. It's not like I won't try another one. I mean, I do like them.
Okay, so you're giving it a what again? I'm sorry.
94, an A.
That's about right, too, because I like
93, 94. That's good.
Yeah. I could have bought a 12-pack from a mixed pack from Left Hand Brewing that had the nitro stout in it and three other nitros they do. And I chose Boulevard's Nutcracker Winter Beer.
Okay. Now, Nina, isn't that a Jefferson Starship song from 1978, All Night Long? All right. Don't even bring up Southern Tier. We haven't gotten that in Louisiana for 6 years.
One of my favorite desserts.
I've had that before.
All right. Well, I'm going to go ahead and start with mine while you're rolling through these.
Yeah, I'm going to do the comments, and you're doing this beer. I'm going to just
Yeah, just keep sure, going. I would like that one guy that Partusius Maximus. When he talked about the 2020 Parabola from Firestone. I've had the 2018. I've not had anything since then. But it's not – it shows up kind of now and then here in Kansas. So it's not something – but I really like the 2018 version. So I would probably like it if they had it. I'm going to give this a 97. If it had more mouthfeel, I would probably give it 100. But I really enjoy this beer. It's really good. It's easy to drink. It's very enjoyable for me. And you got to remember, I'm coming from the bourbon side, and it's got plenty of bourbon flavors in it. And I'm just enjoying that along with the rich coffee. I mean, it's like if you pour bourbon in a coffee from Starbucks or someplace like that, any of your coffee vendors have vanilla coffee, you would have not maybe exactly, but you would have something that would be resembling of this. So I'm enjoying it. 97 out of 100 and empty stomach. I have to admit, I'm kind of feeling just a little bit of it.
Ha ha ha.
I normally don't. That's kind of weird for me. I don't know. We ate early yesterday and all we had was a ham sandwich for dinner and some chips. So that was about 7 o'clock last night. So
I had some corned beef hash and a scrambled egg with some cream and a little bit of cheese and hot sauce and black pepper this morning. Oh, and onions.
I haven't ate breakfast yet. When we get off here, that's the first thing I want to do. Corned beef hash is good. I love that stuff.
Yeah, and then I had three crackers with hog's head cheese, and then I ate some salad with sauerkraut and a black olive and some blue cheese dressing right before we came on air because I could feel my stomach kind of growling. Oh, look at this. Look what Nina says.
Old Speckled Hen has a nitro widget.
That's bizarre.
I've never seen Old Speckled Hen here.
I used to see it back 6 years ago. We used to get a lot of British beers. Michael probably remembers that. We used to get a lot of hen beers.
That's a good stout. I mean, the old Samuel Smith's organic chocolate stout, that's a good stout. There's nothing wrong with it.
My wife really likes that one.
Yeah.
Somebody just mentioned about if we get tenants here, we get some. If you remember, I reviewed that one. I think that was the milk stout I did on Monday, Malty Monday, a tenant milk stout.
I saw a big can of tenants at Total Wine, but it was out of date.
Yeah, did okay. In the one store in town, I've seen tenants now in two different stores in Wichita. The one was out of date. I didn't buy it at the one store, but I went to the other store. That one was in date, and it was a tenant's lager, and it comes in the bigger cans. I'm going to tell you, for a lager, that's really good stuff. I mean, I really enjoyed that.
I was looking forward to it, but I wasn't buying an out-of-date thing. And secondly, it's only 4.4%. And then this kooky guy that was a member of Alcohol X from Scotland, he was like saying to me, "Oi, it's a terrible beer. You don't want to drink it, oi." And I was like, well, I'd try it if I could ever buy it. He's like, I'm going to send you one. And he's telling everybody he's going to send me one. So then I waited, you know, and then a month went by and I was like, okay. And I said, hey, do you have a tracking number on that? And as soon as I asked him that question, he blocked me and quit Alcohol Legs. I'm like, wow. It just goes to show you don't have to be sane to join Alcohol Legs.
DJ, if you were pandering for beer and asking people to send it, and then they said we're going to send it, and they changed their mind, it would be different. But if they're offering and saying I'm going to do it, and then they back out, why would they, you know, go off? Just say I can't do it. You'll understand.
Right. He comes to me publicly and says, "Oh, I'm going to send you one." Oh boy, oh. And I said, okay. I said, but I really don't want people sending me beer. I mean, that's kind of a big expense to send tenants, which is sort of an ordinary product all the way from Scotland. Oh, no trouble, no trouble. I said, okay, well, it's your money, you know. So, but then after a month, I started thinking, I know it doesn't take a month to get beer from Scotland, even if it's during this scamdemic. So I just said, I know, I think something's up. So I said to him, do you have the tracking number? Which is a pretty ordinary question to ask somebody, right?
Yeah.
His response was to block me and quit the group, which I didn't find was a very intelligent or sensible response. And like Michael's saying, I did not go to him. He came to me and offered to send me a beer that he had just declared was not worth trying. Well, you know.
All I got to say is if he thinks Tennant's Lager is a bad beer, then he needs to drink more Bud and Coors and then compare, and then he would understand that that's probably a pretty good beer.
Yeah, it's like Michael said, people, they think it costs $1 to send beer from Scotland to America.
Now, if she got haggis, if Julie got haggis here in the States, it's missing one thing. The States, when they make haggis, cannot put lungs into it. It's against the law in the United States. And you will get the lungs in the haggis when you go to Scotland. But I think taste-wise, it's probably very similar. I've never had the Scottish haggis. I just know that's the difference. So.
No lungs, huh? Never mind. Yeah. I don't want to eat organs. I've said this numerous times on the internet. I don't ask for beer. And if you can ever find any videos I've ever made where I ask for beer, I'll send you money. But you'll never get paid. But I have people hitting me up constantly, and we talked about this, Michael and I talked about this, how they think it's like $1, like they literally think it costs $1. And then when they see how much it costs, I'm sure they're just appalled, you know. But like Michael says, why not just bring it up to me and say, look, it costs too much. I really didn't think it would cost $9 to send $1.50 beer. And I would tell them, well, I don't mind. I mean, I don't care.
I can't remember what I paid for that. I think it was in the $2.50 to $3 range.
That sounds
fair. It's worth every penny. It's worth every penny. I love this stuff. I wish I'd have bought a six pack now.
Look at Ronnie. Ronnie says, don't ask me for a tracking number.
Well, Ronnie likes to be very provocative. He learned from the worst, me. He learned from the worst. He went to Ronald Terrio's School of Internet Etiquette, and he graduated magna cum laude. I would say this cost me $2.39, I think, and it's worth every penny, yeah? Michael's going to say, not really for mine.
You know, it's interesting. I think we get all the Baltica numbers here because we do have a very large Russian and Eastern European population in New York City. So it seems like we get all the numbers. I have never had any great love for the Baltica beers. I haven't had the one you had today, so I have to try that one. It sounded like you enjoyed it, and I would try it for sure. It seems like on some of the other ones, they have off taste that I've found when I've had them, and off to the point that it made it unpleasurable to drink. So
I would not argue with that. And I think even my description today would sort of indicate that in a way.
But you still enjoyed it, even though it depends whether you like prunes and raisins or not. It sounds like if you like prunes or raisins, you might like it.
Yeah, and I qualified my assessment of it by bringing those things up. And remember I said, this is probably not going to be for everybody. It's a bit unusual. And over there in Russia, right, they might be eating smoked herring, and saying, oh, you know, it's so good. But they might be used to flavors that we find aberrant. You know what I'm saying?
So I'm not big on smoked herring. I can eat sardines and mustard sauce, but I've tried to eat herring, and it's just out of the can. It's not my
flavor. I bought some of that, and I put it on crackers, and it was pretty dang good.
I've tried it.
Robert, what about salmon from a can? Can you have salmon from a can? Is that something you like or not?
Walker is good. Okay, I'm sorry. What?
It depends. If you're getting just the round cans of salmon, I prefer to make that into a salmon patty. I like salmon. We will go downtown, or not downtown, but there's a place on the west side of Wichita you can go in. And so basically, they're our closest thing to a fishmonger, and they get pretty fresh salmon. So I get a fillet of salmon and come home, bring home and smoke it. But you can have them do it. It costs a lot more. But I do like salmon, but if you get the little cans with the fillets, those aren't bad. But when they start stuffing it with that in the round cans, it has too much of a wang. I don't know what there's something I don't care for about that.
Maybe it has something to do with the packing of it when it's packed.
Right, that's what I'm thinking too. I mean, I like oysters, smoked oysters out of a tin. I can eat them all day long. But the smoked clams, there's something different. I don't care for the clam flavor. I like the oyster flavor.
What about mussels? Do you like mussels?
Yeah. Well,
not necessarily.
Yes and no. Depends on how they're prepared.
Because that's a Belgian specialty. If you go to Belgium, where we were a couple of years ago, and my wife doesn't eat fish, so she's
oh heck.
But really good Belgian mussels with beer is a really nice combination if they're done right, done correctly. Right. Kind of thing.
Yeah, I got some scallops wrapped in bacon upstairs. I'm going to cook probably today. So
that sounds really good.
Yeah, scallops. I like scallops.
Yeah, I'm a scallop. I'm a shrimp person too.
Yep. Yeah. Well, I've kind of burnt myself out on fried shrimp. I mean, I can still eat it, but I prefer my shrimp on a skewer, just butter and a little dill sprinkled on top of it and just grilled. I mean, that's my favorite way to eat shrimp.
I like that. I like scallops when they're real scallops. Oh, heading off to deal with aged family members. Didn't miss Johnny at all, says Middlebrook. That's not good. All right. Yeah, yeah.
All right, Paul, you have a good day.
I like him, though.
Yeah, Paul's a good guy.
He's fun.
Does anybody want to see what the next whiskey is coming up in the rotation?
Yeah, you already brought it. Let's see it.
No, I didn't. I didn't.
Oh, I thought that's what you went and got.
I didn't get it, by the way. I have to go grab it.
Okay, go grab it. We're always interested.
Chorizo and scallops. That would be an interesting combination. That might be pretty good. I like chorizo.
I'm a sausage person for sure.
Yeah. You can take that chorizo like you get in the grocery store, the hot chorizo. I will take when I'm making chili, I'll take a pound of beef and one of them tubes of that chorizo and squeeze that off in there and then saute that all together in some olive oil prior to starting my chili. And that's really, it adds a lot of good flavor.
I've been doing stuff with chili in a crock pot. And it turned out pretty well.
Yeah.
I have to watch the spice, though. My wife got a little upset. I put an extra cayenne pepper and she got it.
Well, if I lived close, I would be right there.
Got upset, I'd have gotten happy. I'd have been like the Partridge Family. Come on, Tom. You know, I'd have been saying, get happy.
People have their own taste level for cayenne, either like it or when it gets more intense, you can only take so much of it. I'm a spice person, though. I like spice.
So. Okay. Well, here's something that Whiskey Scott's going to either laugh at me with scorn or laugh because he's proud of me. Okay.
I'm fighting hard.
Here it comes.
I never met a person so full of hate. All right.
Full of shit.
I've never
had it. Believe it or not, I've never had it. So
wow, I would try it.
I would try it.
They make it in New Orleans, but most of it's made, of course, in Kentucky.
Yeah.
And I got a deal on this. They were selling it for $17.99.
That's a good deal.
Which I thought was a good price because a lot of places have it for over $20, Anyway,
I've seen it, just never have bought it. There's so many whiskeys that if I try to buy everything I've ever seen, I would be so broke. I would be
right.
I'd be eating peanut butter and bread sandwiches for the next year.
So. I'm a whiskey novice, but isn't Sazerac one of the major manufacturers in the whiskey market?
Well, they own a lot. Sazerac owns a lot of companies and stuff, if I remember right.
Yeah, they own a lot of brands. Like Buffalo Trace, Sazerac, Old Charter.
Yep.
They own a lot of rum brands, vodka brands like Wheatley.
Robert's checking his store.
That's the last rye I bought right there.
Michener's.
Now that cost me $36, I think, for the Michter straight rye. But
was it good?
Ryes are hit and miss with me. Some ryes are really good. Some ryes I don't care for. This one's kind of like, I'm hoping it gets better since it's oxygenated somewhat. I've opened it. It's about a month open now. So I haven't tried it in the last 3 weeks. So
we'll okay, see. Wait. Happens. Two things. First of all, if you say the word missioners around my friend David, he starts screaming, hollering, and saying many negative things. True story. Second thing, somebody's asking a question. Look down at that banner. I'll be right back.
Here I come.
Robert, who was it? When we did the eggnog. We did an eggnog thing on some channel somewhere last year, and I drank the whole bottle while we was online.
Was it on Alex's Friday Taste Challenge thing or something
else? No, I think it was something John did, if I remember right. I'm not sure, but I drank the whole bottle, whole 750 of eggnog. I drank the entire thing. I was actually feeling no pain. I was feeling really good. I was feeling just right.
Get ready, because here I come. Get ready, because here I come. Christian Brothers eggnog.
What is it, 20%?
Give it a good shake. It's only 10% alcohol.
10%, y'all. I could drink the whole thing.
I believe that. I don't know. I believe it. All right. And I got some cinnamon.
Mm-hmm.
Best brand you can get. No, I'm just kidding. All right. Anyway, put a little cinnamon on there. And cheers.
Cheers. Some eggnog on Sunday morning.
I'm not sure what to make of this stuff because I think the predominant flavor in this is peppermint candy. You know, like a candy cane?
Yep.
Yeah.
And then the eggnog just accentuates that. So it's.
If you got peppermint and you're adding cinnamon to it, that's kind of starting to be a little mystery.
Yeah. Now, Jordy says, I've never had eggnog. I'm curious of it. So could one of you guys describe what eggnog would taste like?
It's just a very thick liqueur that. Is whatever they've used to flavor. It's a predominant flavor in eggnog is caramel. You'll get that usually, I think, with most eggnogs. But it's a very thick sort of liqueur that whatever they've spiced it with is generally what you're going to get as far as flavor-wise goes. So,
but it definitely has a strong egg white and egg yolk and cream flavor, right?
Yeah. But usually,
what spice they put in it, because the spice is the uptaste you get in eggnog.
Right. That's been my experience anyway.
That's how it is.
I agree with you.
Oh, yeah. And they're not all the same. If you think they all taste the same.
Oh, wrong. No. Wrong. Yeah. Ron's right. They don't all taste the same. That Dutch one I had last year was the first time I'd had it, and it was really good.
Pennsylvania Dutch. They use real dairy cream. Evan Williams. Benchmark. What's another one? Benchmark, haven't we? The Christian Brothers. You buy four bottles, they're going to taste four different ways, believe me. Mm-hmm. And do you think $9.99 is a good price for these bottles? I think it is.
Yeah, I think that's. You can get it usually for that around here. It's anywhere from $7.99 to $29.99, depending on who's making it and how much you want to spend. It's the same way with eggnog to me is some ways it's kind of like Irish cream. Irish cream starts about $10.99 to $12.99. It goes all the way up to $29.99. And I even bought the one that was $36.99. That was, I can't think of the name of it. But the more you spend on Irish cream, generally the better it gets, except for the case, I still like the St. Brendan, I think it's St. Brendan Irish cream. I still prefer that to the predominant, the one everybody gets, Bailey's.
I tried the Carolyn's.
Yeah, I've had Carolyn's.
Which is Sazerac. I tried the McCormick.
I've tried that. St. Brendan's, I've tried that. Five Farms Irish cream, I've tried that. The Whistler is the one I spent $29.99. I got the Irish whiskey for it, but they have a Whistler. And I think that's the one I paid, like, I think I paid $36.99, which is pretty outrageous for it. Then they have one more that comes in a white tall cylindrical bottle. I can't think of the name of it, but it was really good too. But I think it was exactly at $27.99 or $29.
Look at this comment. Look at this comment.
Guito is awesome. Puerto Rican eggnog. Never heard that. I don't know much about it.
Coquito.
Coquito.
Hey, the bargain brand on sale at Walmart now is Southern Comfort eggnog for $1.99. So if you go to Walmart,
holy take shit. A look.
Well, that must be a time.
Well, I can't buy it. I can't. Our Walmarts don't sell. They sell beer. That's it. They don't sell nothing else.
Oh, we get beer, wine, and liquor at our Walmart. Beer, wine, yeah. And liquor.
If you go there, check to see if you get Southern Comfort eggnog for $1.99.
It must be in a buy thimble. That heartbeat.
It must be in a bottle the size of a thimble, huh?
Sounds like a small bottle though. It does sound like a small bottle.
Yeah.
Now look, no joke, all kidding aside. If I saw Southern Comfort eggnog in a normal size bottle for $9.99, I'd buy that so fast. Scary.
Southern Comfort's an interesting whiskey. It's more like a liqueur to me than a whiskey. It has too many flavors in it. But
yeah, and there's three levels. There's three levels of Southern Comfort. I'm sorry. There's three levels of Southern Comfort. There's the 70 proof, 80 proof, and 100 proof. 100 proof. What, Michael?
It says it's a quart. $2.98 for a quart of Southern Comfort
eggnog. Wait a minute. I know what you're talking about. I think that's made under license from like Borden.
Yeah, it is. It says it here. It is. It's made by Borden.
And there's no alcohol in it.
Oh, so that's just regular straight eggnog.
Yeah, it's just regular eggnog. You got to add your own alcohol, but they use that Southern Comfort name as like a bait to bait people in.
It does say no alcohol. Okay, that's why it's $2.98 for a quart. We now understand where
they're coming. John just commented that.
Oh, yes. I'm familiar with it. And a lot of people probably go home and are enraged because they realize they just bought regular old Borden's eggnog with Southern Comfort's name on it.
Wow.
But it's sort of like that buyer beware because they make no claim to have alcohol in it.
I'm going to have to try that maybe this year. Buy my own eggnog, Borden's eggnog, and add my own crap to it and see what I come up with.
Yeah. Well, I noticed that I've never made my own eggnog infusion. I noticed that Total Wine and More has some strange off-brand eggnogs. You know what I mean? Like brand names you never heard of. I'd like to try some of those. And
I would like to. Like I said, I would. That'd be interesting. I've never tried making my own eggnog either, but Lord knows, I have options.
Maybe I'll make a Johnny Walker Blue Label eggnog.
No, I don't have that option.
I'll charge $35 a glass.
I could probably get close. Never mind. We'll not go there. But we can make it a smoky eggnog with some Islas down here. We can make it some caramely eggnogs. We can make it some bourbon eggnogs, Irish eggnogs, blended Scotch eggnogs.
Yeah, you're really not limited so much. You can really do a lot with that, honestly.
I could do mezcal and tequila
eggnog. Now you're making me want to puke.
I got a lot of choices.
Actually, the wrong alcohol in eggnog would ruin the eggnog. You know, if you put in an off taste, it probably wouldn't do well by it.
How I would do it is I'd buy one quart sacrificial eggnog. I would line up four or five small glasses, and I would pour the equal amount of eggnog in each one, and I would pour equal amount of whiskey in each one to determine which one matched best. Then, after I decided which one matched best, I would do it again, and then I would add different spices to see which spice worked with the whiskey and eggnog. That's how I did when I did my little barrel experiment. You take some time. You just can't.
By the time you finish, though, you'd be feeling no pain because you.
All right, that's common. As long as I'm not puking over the toilet because of some bad eggnog whiskey choice, we're good.
That's true.
The chances of that are probably very low, you know. But
oh no, it could. You can go south pretty quick on some flavors.
Now, Michael has always has interesting products to bring. Tomorrow night on Pumpkin Beer Night on Malty Monday, I'm going to bring Blue Moon Pumpkin Harvest Wheat Ale.
I have Dogfish Head. They're straight 7% pumpkin.
Yes, I can get that. I can get it, but I have so much of that Blue Moon Pumpkin Harvest Wheat, I may as well bring one of those, you know.
I'm not going to do tomorrow's Malty Monday because I'm just not a pumpkin beer guy. I like the one from Sam Adams, the Jacko. That's about my favorite, but I've had my fill of pumpkin. I don't want no more.
You sound like David Garlapied. I told him, I said, I got Pumpkinator from St. Arnold. I got Pumpkinator Strong Ale. I've got Pumpkinator Double Stout. I got this. I got that. He says, you're not tired of drinking pumpkin beers?
I'm with David. You tell David he has a kindred spirit out here.
All that money I laid down for those pumpkin beers, and he tells me, you're not getting tired of drinking pumpkin beers? And he came to my house, and I had a 22-ounce bottle. I had a bomber of Pumpkinator from St. Arnold. And you know what he told me? No, I don't want to drink it. Let's drink the Red's Apple Ale. I said, wow.
Some people, Jay, just don't like pumpkin, I guess.
He likes it, but he just got sick of it. Like, and once he got sick of drinking it, he didn't want to hear about it till next year, you know?
I'm the same way. You have a few, I'm done. I'm not really interested no more.
I'm by no means a big pumpkin beer person, but I will try several of them during the season. And the other one I did have, Jay, was the one that, what's it called? James P. Madonna has done it three
consecutive. Oh, the Flying Dog.
Flying Dog, The Fear. And he gives it a 99. Look, I guess it's in the mind of the person drinking it. And if their taste buds taste 99, all the power to them. I was more in the 90 range, you know, like a B+ kind of thing for it. Bordering on an A minus. It was fine. 9%. It did cover the alcohol, whatever, but I didn't find it to be astounding. He got kind of a stouty vibe to it. I did not. I mean, it was more of just a straight pumpkin beer, but it was fine. Look, there's nothing wrong with an A minus beer. I mean, they're fine. It's just to me, I think
pumpkin beer is sort of a wedge product that kind of divides people. I can understand that.
All right.
Pumpkin itself is a wedge food item. Look at this comment.
Yeah, I can attest to that. When I was in the Army and we were in our over testosterone minded stuff, we used to go around the barracks and collect crickets. And then we'd pour Southern Comfort shots out. You'd put a live cricket on top of each Southern Comfort and shoot it. I could do about four. You can actually feel the cricket's legs when it starts down your esophagus a little bit sometimes. You know how they got the little sharp things on their legs? You can actually feel it scratching your esophagus.
Wow.
And that sounds like a very non-me practice.
But, Jay, you get another benefit. Robert's not telling you. You get another benefit. Crickets are protein. So when it does get down further down, that's a valuable source. A lot of countries have crickets and eat them.
Yeah, that's great. I'll just eat some peanut butter. Thank you very much.
He's not into crickets.
We didn't have many crickets in our barracks, to say the least.
Oh, look at this. I bet Jules isn't the only one.
Those Bacardi. I never really got. Last time I got really totally wiped out on Bacardi, I was running around in my underwear wading through water because we got flooded out. But that's been a long time ago. Had a lot of rain that night.
That's good.
Cricket shooter. So, Jay, what's the next alcohol after your rum challenges are over? What's the next hard alcohol, you're going to do your challenges.
Okay, and we're about to get off the air, y'all. Well, it's going to be the rye whiskey.
So you have other rye whiskeys to do with?
Yes, I have Dickel Rye. I have Jack Daniel's Rye. I have
Dickel Rye is good.
Yeah, I have a number of them actually. So I'm going to do those taste challenges, and then I'll be bringing in bourbon, which is going to be something that John Anile was trying to talk to me about doing an examination with him, and Whiskey Scout might be interested as well. It's called George Dickel 12. Straight bourbon whiskey. It's George Dickel.
Oh, number 12. Yeah. I don't know if I got any of that.
Yeah, well, that's... And then we're going to go to blended whiskey, which Robert is going to be like, never mind. And you know what blended whiskey I have? Old Thompson, which is a very old brand. And Thomas Metal 75, Eric has a bottle of that left over. He might want to know the examination, but I doubt it.
Have no 12.
Well, I bought George Dickel 12 because I got a sale on it at Walmart, a full-size bottle for $12.50.
The 12's good. I like the 12. I don't care for the 8, and I don't care for some of the private barrel stuff they do. Some of this stuff, it's not.
What about the double oak?
It's not so.
But there was no way I was passing up George Dickel 12 and George Dickel Rye for $12.50 a bottle. No way.
I must have drank all that bottle.
You drank it all.
Never mind.
Julie, you crazy. No way.
I drank all the bottle I was talking about. Never mind.
Y'all keep talking. We're about to go off the air. I'll be right back, but y'all keep talking. Hold
Robert, on. What about Bullet Bourbon?
Yeah, I got some bullets.
Are they okay?
I got the barrel strength, which I've had some out of already. I've had one bottle of the regular bullet, and I don't know if I bought a second bottle of it. I do. Yeah, I got a regular bottle here. That was one that was mismarked. That's why I bought it. I only paid $16.49. You can't see it in the damn lights, too.
That's a good price.
$16.49 right, yeah. For $7.50. Yeah, it was mismarked, though. The guy was like, I don't understand that price. It should be more than that. It's ringing up more than that. I said, well, I'll pay the $16.49. I'm not paying no more than that. He rang it up to $16.49.
Yeah, that's ridiculously low. Okay. Here's the answer, and then we're getting off there, I promise. The Sazerac Rye.
Okay.
Here's the competitors. Now, this brand isn't really old. This is not really an old brand. The company's old. The company goes back to the 1840s, but the brand is really only from like the last 20 years. But here's the competitors. Jack Daniel's Rye, which has only been out for 3 years. Pretty good stuff, though. Got a great deal on it. Dickel Rye, been on the market about 10 years ago. From Indiana whiskey. Oh, yeah, you guys.
Got the Jack Daniel's Rye.
Here's the last one so far.
Woodford Reserve
Rye. We got a great deal on this. We got it for half price, so look at this.
Yeah, High West Double Rye.
Yeah. Oh, I can get that. I can get that.
This is the old bottle labeling. I bought a new bottle. I didn't want to drink the old bottle, so I kind of keep this one around.
Robert, Julie is looking at all your stuff, and she's getting, you know, she likes all the stuff you're showing.
Oh, I have a bottle of that unopened.
I have a bottle too, obviously.
All right.
And then, of course, you did already seen the Victor's Rise. That covers all my rise that I currently have.
But you've never had this one, though, huh?
No, I got one more rye.
Have you had
one more rye.
Knob Creek.
Oh, what about this one, Robert?
Have you had Woodford Reserve?
I've never had the Woodford Reserve rye.
Okay, well, Commerce Ozzy has Bullet Rye in his bar. All right, well, thanks, everybody, for joining. We're off the air now. Goodbye.
Hopefully, John will return next Sunday, and we'll be up to normal Stout Operations. Thank you, Jay, for hosting.
Yes,
thank
Jay.
You. I hope I did a credible job at least.
You were great.
You did awesome.
Thank you.
You were awesome.
Oh, thanks.
And Jay, I'll see you tomorrow on Malty Monday.
Yeah, Malty Monday, and I will have a puppet.